Welcome back to Information Service Engineering, lecture number 9, Knowledge Graphs, part 4. In this section of the lecture, we are going to continue our journey with the web ontology language OWL. Okay, let's get straight to it. Next thing we want to learn about are complex class definitions. We have already learned about how to define classes. We have learned how to define properties, data type properties, and object properties, and we have also learned something about individuals. Now, let's come back to the classes. We want to put in more semantics into that. First thing we have to do, before we go to the real complex stuff, we simply want to define classes like we know this from set theory, by, you know, class extension, simply by stating what are all of the members of the class. These are the so-called nominals or enumerated classes, closed classes. We have here an interesting example. So I want to define the carbon dioxide club. And in this carbon dioxide club, we exactly have three members, Joseph Fourier, Jan-Baptiste van Helmont, and Joseph Black. Only three, only these three, nobody else. This is closed, a closed society, the carbon dioxide club. And I define this simply with the help of these OWL nominals. So let's do this. So in the example you see here, I have a chemist, I have a physicist, both classes, and I have Joseph Fourier, who is a physicist, Jan-Baptiste van Helmont, he's also a physicist, and we have Joseph Black, he should be a chemist. And now I define my class, the carbon dioxide club, as a class, and now I say this is one of, and this is the keyword that I need for exactly this kind of enumerated class description. And then here in parentheses, this is important because these parentheses in RDF Turtle define a closed list which cannot be extended any further later on after it has been defined. So it's closed. And in this list, I simply write three names, separated by a blank, not by a comma or anything else, simply separated by blank. I can also write more in then, but once I have defined it, I can't extend it anymore. So I write in there Joseph Fourier, Jan-Baptiste van Helmont, and Joseph Black. This is now a closed class, closed society of the so-called carbon dioxide club. Only these three. These are nominals. To create further complex classes, we can use logical class constructors. So we can use logical AND, this is the OWL intersection. We can use logical OR, a union of classes, or we can also use the complement, which is the logical negation. With that, I can use any combination of classes and class descriptions to create then more complex classes. And yeah, as you see here, they are used to create complex classes from atomic classes, or also then further on use complex classes and make them even more complex. Simple example, let's start here with an intersection. So we define scientists as being an OWL class, and climate activists, also an OWL class. And now we define something here. We define the scientists for future, and these are scientists who are also climate activists. So scientist for future, as you have it here, is defined as an OWL class, which is the intersection of the following classes. And this, of course, can also be more than only two classes. And here I simply list the classes like before in the enumerated class. I list here scientist and climate activist, and with the help of the keyword intersection of, this then is combined to be or to form a complex class with the name scientist for future. So this was pretty simple, class intersection. Union works in exactly the same way. I only show you here a more complex way also to define or to adapt these description logic expressions. I define here environmentalists, and the natural language expression I want to represent formally here is climate activists, animal rights activists, and energy savers are all environmentalists. So I want to define a class environmentalists and say this is equivalent to the following complex class description. So these are climate activists, disjoint with animal rights activists, disjoint with energy savers. Let's explicitly write this now in OWL language. So in turtle serialization, we define environmentalist as a class, and we say this class is equivalent to the following expression. And now the expression I write here in these square brackets, as you know from turtle, what I do here is this is a kind of nested notation for defining here a blank node, and this blank node here has here, as you see here, is connected by a union of to exactly this list of classes. And union of is the property that connects the blank node that stands here with the list of these three nodes that act here as quasi an object: climate activists, animal rights activists, and energy savers. And this is already an abbreviated notation in turtle, but this is a typical turtle notation that you use if you want to define a union. And of course, I can define this here as this class environmentalist being equivalent to that one. So you have exactly the same expression that you have here in description logics. And there are many ways to do this, but this is only one of them that I wanted to present to you. And also to use the last connective that we have learned of the negation. If you want to say that some class is exactly the opposite of another class, we could say here, for example, that warmongers are the opposite of pacifists. In description logics, written in the same way, warmonger is equivalent to the negation or the complement of pacifist. And you can write this in the following way. You define pacifist as an OWL class, and then you say warmonger, it's also an OWL class. However, it's the complement of a pacifist. You could also state this as being equivalent, you know, to, or is the equivalent class to something which is then defined again with a blank node and again these square brackets, and then you write in the square brackets complement of pacifist, like you did the definition on the last page, but this is a shorter version which express exactly the same. Okay, now we had examples for all the three connectors: for conjunction, for union, and for negation. However, there are more ways to create complex classes in OWL. Now it's really getting interesting. Now we are coming to the so-called property restrictions. And there, new classes are created with the help of properties and restricting simply the range on which the property can be applied. And we can say that these restrictions apply to values of this range or to the cardinality. Let's start with the range restrictions here with on values. Most easiest one is we can use a restriction with a constant. Let's start the other way around. We first look at the example we want to define here in natural language. We want to say that Fourier's discoveries have been discovered, of course, by Joseph Fourier. So Fourier's discoveries is all or everything where exactly the property discovered by is restricted to only one individual, to Joseph Fourier. So all things that Joseph Fourier has discovered should then be in that class. Looking at that in description logics, you define here Fourier's discoveries as being here, for example, a subclass of, you could also state here equivalent. And then you say the property discovery, and you restrict it, you do this here by the period, and you restrict it to a constant, to one individual, and you write this individual then here in parentheses, and there you write simply Joseph Fourier, which means all of the individuals that are in this class, they have a property discoverer. However, the value of exactly that property is restricted to the individual Joseph Fourier. So the object here is always Joseph Fourier, which means the class Joseph Fourier's discoveries is described by a fixed value assignment. It's a constant of the individual Joseph Fourier to the property discoverer. Let's have a look at this in our turtle syntax. So we again describe here Fourier's discoveries as an OWL class, since we here are using the subclass relationship. We say here, this is an RDF subclass of. And now again, I define here blank node. So again, square brackets. And here now I define first, this is a restriction. So I define here a complex class via property restriction. The restriction is on a specific property. So I use the owl keyword owl on property. The property I restrict here is discoverer. And now I have to say which value I apply this on. So owl has value is the keyword that now I can define to the individual of Joseph Fourier. And you see here in this square brackets, everything what I write here only consists here of property and again then the object. And therefore it has the same subject, which is the blank node for which here exactly the square bracket stands. So simply to remind you of the turtle syntax, and therefore also all of these triples are here concluded by a semicolon and not by a period, because the same subject is again applied here, which is exactly this blank node. So we have this nested notation again. So these are our property restrictions based on constants. Now we are going to loosen that a bit and to make it more complex, since now we want to restrict the range of a property not to a specific individual, but with individuals that come from a specific class. And therefore, we are distinguishing between so-called strict binding and loose binding. Strict binding means the individuals must only come from this class, and it's not possible that there is an individual in the class that I define which has a property which goes to another class, which is also part of this restriction. Might seem complicated, but it's really, really easy. Let's explain this with an example. So I want to say the ingredients of a vegetarian dish are only vegetarian food. As soon as one of the ingredients of a vegetarian dish is not vegetarian anymore, the entire dish is not vegetarian anymore. That's clear. So I want to define here a vegetarian dish, and I want to say the property ingredient of that dish, all of these ingredients must be member of the class vegetarian food. So therefore, this is a kind of universal quantification. All of them are restricted to that. There is no other ingredient involved there. So a vegetarian dish only has, of course, ingredients which are vegetarian food. And I define this in the same way that I say I have the old keyword all values from. So all values which, of course, are bound to that property must be of a specific class C. So this is a strict binding. Writing this then in owl turtle language, I define vegetarian dish as a class. And to mimic here again this subclass relation, I write RDF as subclass of. And then I write again here square brackets, define a blank node, a nested blank node, and say again, this is a restriction on a specific property. This time the property is called ingredient. And now I don't restrict this to a single value. I restrict this to members of a specific class. And I say all of them must be vegetarian food. There are no exceptions and also no other, you know, values for this ingredient for all of the vegetarian dishes. That's a strict binding. What does it mean? Simple example. So let's say I define kimchi to be a vegetarian dish. And I have an ingredient of kimchi, which is cabbage. By having now or using exactly this description, I could deduce via logical inference that cabbage must be a vegetarian food. If cabbage is not a vegetarian food, then I would see that there is an inconsistency contradicting to the class definition. And I would see, yeah, this is not allowed. So this is how I can make use of exactly these kind of class restrictions. However, there is also another definition for a so-called loose binding, strictly for the case when there it's also possible that other kind of values are allowed. However, we say that This one single value, amongst others, exists. Simple example that we want to formalize here. I want to say a reader reads, amongst other things, also books. So a reader, of course, might also read a newspaper, he might read a letter, but we define reader that a reader has to read a book besides other things. But he has to read a book. Then we call him reader. So writing this in DL, again, I define a reader here and say the restriction is on the property reads. And here it's restricted to the class book. However, I use here not universal quantification, I use existential quantification, which allows also other classes here besides book for things which are here in the class reader. But of course, there must be at least one property value connection to book for these members of the class reader, otherwise it's not allowed. So I use here the OWL keyword some values from, and this describes that there must exist an individual P and so an individual for the property P and fixes its range to class C in a loose way, in loose binding. Let's have a look at the turtle definition here again. I define reader as a class and I say this is a subclass of, and now again in square brackets, on a restriction on the property, this time it's reads, and here I take some values from book. So in our example, this would read, for example, I am a reader, so I define myself, Harald, as of type reader. I read Brave New World, which is of course of type book. However, it's also allowed that I can read other things, like for example, the New York Times, which is a newspaper. You remember in the definition here for the vegetarian dish, as soon as one of its ingredients was not of the same class like defined here, then this was already invalid. It wasn't a vegetarian dish anymore. But here with a loose binding, I stay a reader also if I'm reading something which is not a book, if I'm reading, let's say, a newspaper, if I'm reading a letter or anything else, or if I'm reading a poem, for example. So this is the difference between loose binding and strict binding. Okay, so let's continue with cardinality restrictions. This is also rather interesting. I give you an example. I want to define what's a string quartet. I want to define that a string quartet has exactly four members. Without telling right now that they have to play strings, it should be four, exactly four members. So what I want to define here, again in description logic syntax, would look the following way. I define a class string quartet, and I say that here on the class, on the property member, there is a restriction that no matter what class or individual these members are, they must be exactly four. And you write this also with this here dot notation in that way. So any instance of class string quartet must have exactly four values for the property member. Let's define this in turtle syntax. String quartet, now it's an old class and this is a subclass of, again, I define here my expression as nested blank node as a restriction on the property member, and I say now here that the cardinality, this is the keyword I use here if I want to restrict the cardinality to an exact number, should be 4. And 4 is of type integer here. It's not a string, it's 4 of type integer. And besides having exactly a fixed number, you can also define here upper and lower bounds. And you use then there, instead of OWL cardinality, you use OWL max cardinality for giving a maximum, so which is then an upper bound, or you say OWL min cardinality, which gives a lower bound on a property value restriction or value cardinality in that sense. So these are value restrictions and complex classes based on value restrictions and cardinality restrictions we had here in the last example. Okay, now let's make a little quiz in the end. So a vegetarian does not eat animals. How would you model this? Is it loose binding? Is it strict binding? So as soon as I eat something else, which is and animals, then I wouldn't be a vegetarian anymore. So I'm only allowed to eat something which is not an animal. Okay, how to model this? I can model it in the following way. I say a vegetarian is a class. Then I model it as again as a restriction on a property eats. And I say that all values of it must be, and there is not animals, which means I define here some class which is, again, I can't say exactly what is it, but I give a complex class definition here and say this is the complement of animal. You see here, this is again already a bit more complicated. I define here, I have two complex additions in that class. One is a property restriction, a strict binding on things which are not animals. And the second one here, I define a class which is not an animal, which is the complement of an animal. Second example, a driver is somebody who drives a car. Can this driver also drive something else? Is it still a driver if the driver, let's say, let's also drive a bicycle? No, of course, then it's also a driver, but he should drive a car. Then we call him driver. Okay, so we model this now with the restriction on the classes driver and car and the property drives, and we would do it in the following way. Of course, this is then a loose binding because he's also allowed to drive something else. A driver is an old class, and I define this as an owl restriction on the property drives, and here I simply say owl some values from car. So you see here, loose binding, strict binding, it's not so complicated at all. However, it already provides lots of semantic expressivity, and this of course means much, much more flexibility and the ability to create much more sophisticated statements and assumptions compared to something like RDF or RDFS. But of course, this is not the end. I can do even more with OWL, and how this goes, you will see then in the next part of this lecture.